one at a time, and my life ain't worried about you feel it, feel it. Got my head on straight, I got my vibe right. I ain't gonna let you kill it. See,
good afternoon. Thank you, Lane Davis, for that wonderful song. We Will Rise Up. I love this conference and I am delighted to be here. I'm Bethia Carter, president of New England Blacks in Philanthropy, and we are so delighted to be a part of this day. Black women rock. Yes, we do, because we rise up and others rise with us each and every day. This conference is not just about leading the change for social and political charge in our community, but also celebrating how we lead. I am so delighted to be here with all of my sisters, including my Congresswoman, Ayanna Pressley, Susan Taylor, my mentor and personal shero, and now Cheryl Lee Ralph. Ms. Ralph is a multifaceted artist who continues to blaze trails in the entertainment industry. Whether she's on film, television, Broadway stage, Ms. Ralph always sparkles. As a director, a voice, a screen actor, author, singer, philanthropist, community activist, wife, and mother, she does it all and does it all beautifully. She can be seen in Freeform series Motherland Fort Salem, performing as U.S. President Kelly Wade, and closing out the last season of Ray Donovan as Mickey's love, Claudette. Ms. Ralph recently launched Diva Define, a podcast featuring powerful women making moves in their various career paths, and a new digital talk series, Divas Simply Quarantined, on Facebook Live. Aside from her career pursuits, she is a fierce community activist and advocate. She's a powerful voice in activating citizens, all of us, to vote, and has designed her own line of Vote and Power activism apparel, which you can find and purchase at shopwithcherylee.com. Ms. Ralph also produces an annual benefit concert, Divas Simply Singing, which raises awareness for HIV, AIDS, and other life-threatening diseases like hunger, poverty, and the racial disparities in communities of color, particularly during this time when we have been so ravaged by COVID-19. This year will mark the 30th year of the event and 31 years of her foundation, the DIVA Foundation, that she started when she was 2. The week-long event will be held virtually during the first week of December and will culminate in the 30th annual Diva Simply Singing televised concert from Los Angeles. Ms. Ralph has received numerous community awards and accolades for her commitment to service. In February of this year, Ms. Ralph was one of 7 creative legends honored for her contributions to the arts and entertainment in the city of Los Angeles and beyond. Ms. Ralph was inducted as an honorary member of Delta Sigma Theta sorority in July of 2004 for her HIV and AIDS activism at the 47th National Convention in Las Vegas, Nevada. She was also awarded the first Red Ribbon Award at the UN for creating the Red Ribbon Diva T-shirt for HIV, AIDS, and awareness. She has been awarded numerous accolades, honorary degrees, and humane letters for her work from places such as Houston Tolson University and Toluso College. She resides in Los Angeles with her husband, Senator Hughes. And without further ado, I present to you Ms. Cheryl Lee Ralph. Thank you for joining us today.
Mute myself. There we go. Everybody, I am true to my game. I wear it on my face. I need you to vote. Need you to vote. I need you to get a plan together to vote, because I don't want you to just vote. I need you to vote successfully. Now, some people say, that's a Black woman right there. Yes. That's a Black woman right there. Because believe it or not, Black women across this country in very many states will be the defining power of success. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for. I'm just going to tell you, I need you to vote like your life depends upon it. And when you wear a mask like this, you spread the message and not the disease. Spread the message, not the disease, okay? And I just proved that we can talk and we can be understood when we wear masks. It's very interesting for me, you know, in this cycle, wearing something like this that says vote. I had no idea just how powerful four letters were. It's amazing. Sometimes I walk down the street and people will be, they're looking at me. And I said to myself, wow, you never know what it is that you are doing and the kind of effect you can have on others. And right about now, others need to feel a positive effect that they must get out there and vote. Anybody who says that their vote does not matter, what they're actually saying is, I do not matter. And what I do does not matter. So right now, I want to encourage everybody to know just how much you matter. Please make a plan in these next 39 days or earlier to get yourself together to vote successfully. Vote successfully and correctly. If Corona's got you nervous, make sure you are registered to vote. Apply to vote early, vote by mail. But by all means, I don't care if you're 19, 18, I don't care if you've been incarcerated before, I don't care. I need you to make sure that you are registered properly. Your name is still on the voting log, that you are there and ready to be counted with your vote. Now, in gatherings like this, very often I realize I'm speaking to the choir. So choir, I need you to take it up an octave. Choir, I need you to learn a new verse to the song. And if you're a woman and you're planning to vote, plan to take a man with you. Plan to talk to a man about it. Because just like women of color are important to this voting cycle, men of color are very important to this cycle. So please, get it together. Make a plan to vote successfully. All right. Now, I know you heard in my introduction that I'm a proud member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority, Incorporated. So to all of my sorors that may be on and watching, you know we look good in every color. And this pink that I'm wearing, first of all, I love fuchsia. Not as much as I love red, but I love fuchsia. So this pink is because Breast Cancer Awareness Month, October, is coming up. And I really want to spread a message that women, we must truly value ourselves, value our health, value our family, our children, so much so that we learn how to do that monthly self-examination, that we keep up on our annual medical checkups, that we put ourselves first enough to go to the doctor and find out what's going on. It's important. You're important. Your life is important. And if you want to find out how different it is, please don't. So get your checkups. Do your self-checkup. I have a film coming out, you heard, that I am directing these days, and I love it. And I just directed a piece for BET Her, which is going to air on Saturday, I believe it's the 17th. I know it's awful. I should know my own air date.
but it's part of the Waiting Room series. And in this series, we are covering the topic of breast cancer awareness. So please tune in, watch it, have conversations with your sisters, your friends, your sorors, your family about how important it is to get your annual checkups, to do your monthly self breast examination, because you are so important to life. If you're not there, everything changes for so many people. So please do it for all of us and take good care of yourself. Okay, that was the description, that was the explanation for the pink. Now the green is because that's a green screen. And usually when I'm on Zoom, but we're not on the Zoom platform today, I can change my background. I can make it wherever it is I want it to be. But I didn't have enough time to change it so that you could look at what my grandmother used to call the chiffereau. The chiffereau is that cabinet where all of the plates and things go, but I didn't have time to take it down. So you got me in the pink and the green. There you go. But with that, some of you were listening to something that I just felt that I had to do something during the coronavirus. And people kept saying, talk to us. So I would come on in the evening and I would simply start to say, so how are you doing? And for whatever reason, that caught on. But more than that, what caught on was my reading from my book. I'd written a book some time ago called Redefining Diva. Now, the first thing you should know for me is Diva is much more than just the word. It's an acronym. Divinely inspired, victoriously alive, awesome, audacious, aware. And if it were Sunday, we would be anointed Diva. Diva. And I was listening to some of the conversations earlier today because there were so many people that came on that had such wonderful things to say. And I wanted to read something to you all because I have now, because so many people asked for it, I have done the audio book. So there will be an audio book that will come out concurrently with the film on BET Her. The film is called Like, Comment, and Subscribe, by the way. The book, Redefining Diva, you'll be able to get it on Audible. But there was one chapter that I read and rewrote. And I'm just going to read this to you. As I look back, my days in Dreamgirls, some of you know that's exactly where I started, on the Broadway stage, were some of the greatest and most challenging of my life. For the good times, I'm eternally grateful. Having the opportunity to reach audiences every night, to see their faces light up with joy as they watched us. And they gave us the opportunity through our art to move them to tears. Being a part of such an iconic show was a blessing. Dreamgirls, very much like Hamilton, the musical, is today, was revolutionary. Finally, there was a stage full of beautifully Black, obviously Black, no mistaking what we were, Black women on that stage. We weren't stereotypes or the background characters. No, we were the show itself. And to be a part of creating something so ahead of its time, and something that would open the doors for countless young Black actresses everywhere to follow, well, I think you know, that just makes me, to this day, still feel so good. But part of opening doors, part of being a pioneer, part of being the first, well, it's not always easy. And people aren't always kind once you do get in to the other side. Those early Dreamgirls days would offer a lifetime of lessons, and some of those lessons would be painful. more wake-up calls would occur in the short span than most women have in their entire 20s. I was 23 when we started working on the show. I'd always been overly trusting of people. I'd been raised with a community who looked out for me, and they believed in me. Mm-hmm. And they treated me with heartfelt kindness. My family, my neighbors, my block, my church. There was a feeling of loving community. And even through difficult experiences in Hollywood, I had kept the faith that people were genuinely good at heart. They struggled as we all do, but if they said that they wanted the best for you, well, I believe them. Well, that, my diva, is an unfortunate lesson because it isn't always true. You have to find the good people, the ones that really want the best for you. And you got to hold them close when you do find them. And don't get fooled. Well, actually, that's just part of learning. Having women that I share my thoughts with, my ideas, my struggles, my pain. See, that's very important to me. My mother taught me the importance of sisterhood. I told you that I'm a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. And when I see my sorors and other women in other organizations come together and succeed, I feel good about that. Because you see, I share in their success. I don't have to look at somebody else and say, well, why did that happen to her? No, that was supposed to happen to her. And I'm happy for her, because maybe if I work that way, if I find the path that she was on or create my own path, I can have that same kind of success. But I digress. You see, backstabbing, demeaning, trying to undermine the success of your sisters, well, that has always seemed plain crazy to me. That is why I celebrate all women who celebrate sisterhood, no matter what color they wear. Crimson and cream, pink and green, blue and white, green and white, it doesn't matter, blue and gold. I celebrate sisterhood. Now, Black women, and Black women truly do rock, have always had to work harder than anyone else. When we left the African continent under pain and duress and were put to back-breaking, brutal work throughout the American continent, this is what we did and do. We worked. We have always been working women. We did our share, more than our share. And then we kept on. We kept going. Because see, we didn't have a choice. When our great-great-grandmothers were out working in those fields and they happened to be pregnant, well, they didn't have a choice. They didn't get time off for leave, for childcare. They didn't get time off to recharge. No, they dropped those babies in the hot sun, wrapped them up, strapped them to their backs, and resumed work. They didn't have time for petty stories or nasty behavior. They had better things to do, like survive. See, those are the women that we come from. This is our legacy, and I've been taught not to forget that. And you shouldn't forget it either. Because somebody picked cotton for my dream to come true. And you're in New England. Somebody built a ship for your dream to come true. And here I was on the grander stage, literally, than I could ever have imagined. There were so few roles for Black women out there, and I'd landed one of the best of them. Mm-hmm. And not everybody was happy about it. But I learned haters are gonna hate. And sometime you have to thank God for your haters, because if you are not distracted, you will double down on your plan for success. And I truly believe that when women work together and support each other, there's a lot of power in that. And that kind of power can change the world for the better. Change the world for the better. In times like this, that's what we've got to be about, embracing change. And change is not easy for anybody. Okay, so at the beginning of the coronavirus, I slid down the stairs. Oh, honey, it was like a real cartoon. Boom, 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 boom. I could feel my head just pom, 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 down every doggone step. Lord! And I got up and I was like, okay, I'm fine. I didn't break anything. I was fine. But the next day, oh my goodness gracious, I hurt from the top of my head to the tip of my toes. I called my doctor right away. I said, first of all, tell me what to do. She said, well, don't take an aspirin. Take Tylenol and an ibuprofen. So that's acetaminophen and the ibuprofen together. Drink lots of water. I can't see you, but I'm going to give you some physical therapy. Who knew that you could take ibuprofen and acetaminophen together and it helps you feel much better? I didn't know that. Doctors didn't tell us that, but anyway, we know now. So I take it, I get into the physical therapy. In physical therapy, sometimes to make you stronger and engage muscles that you've forgotten about, they put you on a surface that's uneven, like a trampoline or one of those half balls. And they make you stand on it at first with two feet on it. And you wobble because what they want you to do is feel uneasy, engage your muscles so that you can steady yourself. And the moment you get strong enough to steady yourself on 2 feet, they say, now do it on one leg. And you wobble back again. You wobble back again, thinking, oh, I had arrived. And they were like, oh no, there's more. And you wobble on that one leg until you get yourself steady again. Then they make you do it on the other side. But I realized that very often, my God, that is life. Sometimes you've got to be very uncomfortable to steady yourself. And you've got to want the healing to move forward, because it is hard to learn about things in yourself, in your body, that you had forgotten about or you didn't even know you had. It's not easy. And it's interesting because Corona has shown us just how uncomfortable things can get. And I don't want us to take it for granted that things can't get worse. So when I talk about being uncomfortable and getting strong and getting yourself ready for change, take it seriously. Because we are very challenging times, and it's up to us, women, people in the community, human beings that are alive, folks who know better, to do better. They say to one much is given to, much is required. That's serious. That means something. When I wrote in my book about petty behavior, we've got to leave a lot of that behind. Too many people are trying to figure out who it is they're not on this side. I'm telling you, I agree to disagree. People always ask me, why do you watch that channel? I want to know what they're thinking. I want to know what they're doing. I want to know. I know how I feel, but there's more than just me in the world. I want to know how somebody else feels and thinks. I might not be on that page with them, but I just want to know, right? When I talk about having conversations about this, someone said to me, well, that's brave. And I was like, is it? And then I realized, heck, maybe it is. But if there, what if, and in this year of, you know, women's right to vote, what if, and it was only for some women, what if Sojourner Truth wasn't brave enough to walk, hear me now, walk behind the suffragists? And finally, when she got fed up, she bared her chest and she said, ain't I a woman? That's brave. And guess what? There was nobody with a camera to film it. But it really happened. And the story is so powerful, we still tell it today. She said, ain't I a woman? And she watched the white women before her get treated well and helped down from the carriage. She said, ain't nobody ever put no coat down in the dirt for me. I could eat as much as any man if I and when I could get the food. That's some bravery right there. That's going all the way. And right about now, some of us are going to have to step up and be very brave. Some of us are going to have to go all the way. Because if we embrace this thing, talking about Black women rock, we're going to have to rock the boat. We're going to have to rock the polls. We're going to have to rock some of the way people think. We're going to have to rock some of the way people don't think. We're going to have to rock the vote. A lot of people upset about what happened with Breonna. We all are upset because we feel, and it's really true, that this Black woman's life didn't really matter. But guess what? We got to vote about it because they got certain kind of crazy laws across this country. And they got crazy laws in Kentucky. We might have the way we think about it in other states that don't have something called a no-knock. We also know that they might not do a no-knock in an affluent white neighborhood, but in communities of color, impoverished communities, it was easy to just go in and bust the door down. They also have a right to carry state, which means you can carry your gun. You're out there, you're watching the protests, you're watching all kinds of people with their guns and their rifles and their AK-47s, and a lot of us are like, what the hell? But that's how they do. That's their law, right? So then you bust down the doggone door, the boyfriend hears all this noise, she's in her bed, he takes out his gun and he shoots at the police officer. And then guess what? All bets are off because they got another law that says if you shoot with your right to carry gun to protect yourself and you think somebody's breaking in your house, it happens to be a police officer and you shoot at him, you are in the wrong. So all bets are off. And if Breonna got shot 6 times sleeping in her bed, well, that's what happens. And that's why Black women got to rock
the vote.
We got to vote. And all of us who have family across this country, we got to talk to them about rocking the vote. Okay. Now, I know that I do not have too much more time. And we have questions and answers. And please ask me questions because I've got lots of answers. Okay, thank you. All right, I met Maya Angelou. And I'd met Maya Angelou at several times over her life. And towards the end of her life, she came and heard me speak. And I had my children with me, and she told me to bring my children. And, you know, she could hardly lift her head up at that time. And she looked at me and she said, "Cheryl Lee Ralph, when I hear you speak, I think to myself, my, 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 it has all been worth it." I'll never, ever forget that, never. Okay, so there was a chapter here. And I wanted to read this one because you got to find your joy, all right? As wonderful as you are, as much as Black women rock, I don't care who you are, you must find your joy. I often meet young women who hate their jobs. They don't like the people they work with, and they don't like what they do. Now, see, if I'd gone in another direction, I'd have been just like them, because my mother's dream for me was to be a doctor. But it ain't gonna happen. Anyway, wondering, I would be unhappy, wondering why I can't find and keep a good relationship. And here's what I tell those women. If you are working at something and it is not making you happy, well, you need to find yourself another job. If you don't find your work fulfilling, well, you need to find another job. If you don't wake up in the morning with a feeling that you just can't wait to get to work, even if that is rolling out of your bed and turning on your computer, if you don't feel like you have got to do and be the best you can possibly be, well, you probably know exactly what I'm about to say. If you take a job just to have a job, then you aren't really living. You are just surviving, not thriving. Now, don't get me wrong. Sometimes a woman has got to do what a woman has got to do to put food on the table. But she knows to find her joy at all costs, because a real woman thrives. You got to thrive if you're going to rock life. There are millions of reasons and excuses to keep you from finding your joy and the work that fulfills you. The uncertainty of stepping out on faith alone, the fear of rejection, people telling you that it is impossible because it hasn't been possible for them. Did you hear what I said? They're going to tell you it's impossible because it hasn't been possible for them. Others thinking that you have lost your mind or you are just plain crazy, which leads you to think, what about the rent? What about my hair? What about my nails? What about my designer morning latte? What about all that? Are you going to lie down and roll over with the daily unhappiness and say, well, I guess that's it? Of course not. You, the divinely inspired, victoriously awesome one, the diva one, you. Like the young woman said at the beginning of this, you are going to rise again, again, and again to the challenge of your own life. Don't sit on the sidelines of your life, because if you are a woman, a Black woman who rocks, you better get up, get out there, find it within yourself, because trust me, it's there. Get up, get out and rock your life. I'm Cheryl Lee Ralph, and I love you just the way you are, because it's perfect, because God really does not make mistakes. And you know, God must be a woman, because the world is such a wonderfully beautiful and intricate thing. So I thank the great goddess up there. And I thank you too for listening. And I'm ready for your questions.
Thank you, Queen Diva, Ms. Ralph. I had to send a note to somebody and say, oh my Lord, what's this? Because we're going to rock the vote. Thank you so much. And we want one of those masks. We need to know where we can buy those masks. Because we're going to rock the vote with the mask.
Oh, thank you. Very simple. Just either you follow me on Instagram and follow the link in my bio, or just go to shopwithcherylee.com.
So ladies, I invite you to put your questions in the chat. There's just so much I want to ask you.
Thank you.
So while we are waiting for a few questions, we have a couple of questions that came in. You know, Brianna just took us someplace, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm so happy you talked about her. She was murdered before George, yet you hear nothing. George first and her second. You heard nothing. So it can be sometimes just hard to hold on to that joy. So what do you do when you stumble to help you go back and find your joy?
I was talking about this with a friend of mine this morning. And I have to, and this is just Cheryl now. I live my life doing the best I can every day. Sometimes I fail. Sometimes I'm not very good at it, but I do the best. And I keep trying to tell other people, do the best with what you have right where you are, knowing that probably at the end of every day, you are perfect right where you are, because you have done the best with what you have. And do not play down what it is you have. Sometimes you might only have a smile that you can give somebody. Don't underestimate the power of your smile. Sometimes the only thing you can do is make somebody else realize that they're okay, that they are not losing it. Don't underestimate that, because that might be exactly what that other person needed. So do not underestimate the power of you, no matter how little or small or big it is. You're probably doing just enough, as long as you're doing something.
So I have another question that came in. You started your podcast during this season of COVID, but we're interested in learning more about your podcast. Do you plan to keep it going? How do we tune in? We want more of this.
What I started to do was I evolved that into every Sunday at 7 p.m. If you go to Facebook Live under Divas Simply Singing, Divas Simply Singing Facebook Live every Sunday at 7, I started bringing very interesting people into a conversation. And it's so interesting, because some of these people think they know. And then when you listen to them tell their stories, you're like, whoa, I had no idea. So this Sunday, we have Jody Watley. You know, Jody Watley in the 90s, yes, I know. Jody Watley in the 90s was so far ahead of her time. You know, people used to look at Jody Watley and they were like, what's she got on? What? Who goes out into the street in that? You know, and she's really just a wonderful human being. Jody Watley, and I won't, you know, I'm not going to tell her whole story, but Jody Watley literally started this whole thing of recording all of her songs when she couldn't afford a band. And she would get up on stage and she timed out her own act pre-recorded so that you could enjoy all of her songs. I was like, that's what people do now. I was like, girl, so far ahead of your time. So we have a great lineup of people every Sunday at 7 p.m. People can go and they can watch.
Great. Another question just came in. How does your work now during COVID, the pandemic, compare to the work that you were doing in the early stages of HIV/AIDS?
Thank you for that question. You know, I learned so much as a young woman joining the fight against AIDS. And I learned that people, when they're afraid, find it very easy to find somebody to hate, to find somebody to dislike, to find somebody to withhold care from. And when I saw that happen as a young girl, you know, because 23 in my mind was a young woman. To see that happen, the little church girl in me was like, wait a minute, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Don't do unto others before they do unto you and you don't know what it is they're doing. I was like, I was like, oh my God, we've got to do better. And besides, you know, I was becoming a woman and I had friends who were helping me with my wig, weave, weft, and wardrobe problems and they were just dropping dead. I was like, wait a minute, we got to find out ways to help them. We've got to be there for them. They need us. And to see people turn their backs, it was horrible. You would sing and dance on Broadway with somebody one night, the next night, they'd be fighting for their life. Their parents would dump their kids off on church stair steps like they were garbage or clothes for a rummage sale. When I saw all these things, I said, we can do better. When I see how we are not caring for people right now for COVID-19, when I see how there are some people, a certain person who said, oh, it's no big deal, so much so that 200,000 people have died and we hardly care. I mean, really care? That is hurtful. When we talk about a mask and we can't get people to wear a mask to save others, and we know it is a proper, proven protection, and they don't want to wear them because it's uncomfortable. The same way condoms were uncomfortable back then, couldn't get people to wear condoms, take condoms, talk about condoms. Come on now. It's history repeating itself. And the way America did not hold back, how they hated gay people. They didn't hold back on that. I was like, my God, and now you got people showing you how much they can't stand Black people, brown people. Out with the hate, up front with the hate. And you know what these viruses do? They mutate and they get stronger. So whatever you think you're learning right now, you better be ready to learn some more, because the next virus, and there will be another one. Oh, you better help somebody right now so that somebody will be around to help you, because what we see right now is, didn't care about gay people back then. Now the next folks, see, they don't care about this. Who they're not gonna not care about next? Who? We got women in detention getting hysterectomies. They didn't ask for that. Anyway, don't get me started because you know how I am. I'll talk about it. Next question, please.
All right, Reverend Ralph. Thank you, Reverend Ralph, for that moment. You know, as Black women, we start out as Black girls and we watch our mothers, right? And we watch our mothers, good, bad, great, all of it. How did your mom influence you?
Wow.
And where you are today?
You know, I write about that in my book. Oh my goodness. My mother was probably, and I lost my mother 2 years ago. And you know,
oh, that. I'm sorry.
Me too.
That's a horrible club.
You never get over it.
Never.
You never get over it. And I had a great father. I adored my father. My father adored me. But the habit of my mother is something that is just so, wow, I don't even know how to, you know, to get around it or anything sometimes. But my mother, I'm an immigrant's child. My mother was a strong Jamaican woman. And when my mother came to America, my mother, when I was born, she said, Cheryl, we are in America now. And she had such a great way of talking to me. Cheryl, we are in America now. And you must know that there are a lot of people you are going to meet here. They don't like you. They don't like you. But these people here, they will stab you in your back. So you must have eyes in the back of your head and eyes in the front of your head so that you are safe in your goings and your comings. Wow. She was always so ready to pour out the wisdom, to pour out the wisdom of life. And I'm so happy that I'm sure the great goddess up there chose her to be my mother so that I could reap the benefits of her life. And that now I can share that with my daughter. And you know, life, like Sojourner said, life ain't been no crystal stair, honey. Shoot, I do not look like my journey. So all I can do is thank my mother for that too, because I make a rough journey look very good. Thank you. And I'm sure there are a lot of women out there and a few men who love us watching today. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. You know, you make your journey look very good. That's right. So I thank my mother for her power. I thank my mother for her strength. I thank my mother for just keeping, for carrying on. And I thank my mother for holding me close. And I thank my mother for giving me life, because it was Miss Ivy Ralph. And she was given the Order of Distinction in Jamaica for what she did for her country. And I always said it was Ivy Ralph OD, Original Diva. So thank you.
Well, we love the Original Diva and we love the Queen Diva. And so our last, we have a question.
Yes.
Not a question, a statement. We just want to let you know how much we love you and how much we have adored this conversation. But I do have my last question here. You know, we're celebrating resilience, versatility, and courage. And when you think about the future, you're looking out, you're looking at your beautiful daughter, your grandchildren, where do you see the future of Black Power?
First of all, thank you so much for seeing that my daughter will one day have children. Oh my goodness, thank you. Oh, I tell you, my son and daughter have come this far in life and there have been no surprises, for which I'm very thankful. But I had my children later in life. And as I get on in life, I say, wow, I wonder if I will have children. But I always say this to my children. I may one day be blessed with grandchildren, but I know right here, right now, that I have done my part by pouring into my children. And the relationship that I have with my children, if it could be any better with grandchildren, then wow, because I have had a wonderful time raising my children. In this time of protest, since George Floyd, my children, I guess, have seen my example, because they, every Sunday, Saturday and Sunday, they gather hundreds of young people in Los Angeles to come together, to take to the streets, to protest peacefully. On Sunday, they present an open mic for young people to heal themselves by making sure they are heard by others. And then they do yoga, which is healing in itself. So I say, if I have two young people that are doing things like that. I have faith in Black power because they are learning and seeking healing at the same time. And that is a wonderful thing. They are opening their arms to receive other young people, and not just Black and brown people either, to come into the circle and learn with them. And that is a powerful thing. And you can follow on Walk Good LA. It's called Walk Good LA. And they meet across from LA High every Saturday and Sunday. So I have hope. I have hope that there will be young politicians that will follow in the footsteps of my husband, Senator Vincent Hughes of Pennsylvania, not California. My husband is a senator in Pennsylvania, the city of Philadelphia. And I'm hoping that other young people will step up, especially young women, and run for office. Run for anything. Nobody is smarter than you. Nobody is better than you. Run for office and learn the way many of them have done.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being an inspiration to us. Thank you for your beauty of your soul, your music on Broadway, all of it. We thank you so much for everything that you have imparted in us today.
I want to thank Jerianne for inviting me. I met Jerianne years ago. Jerianne has stayed in touch with me. Jerianne looks good for her journey too. So Jerianne, I love you, Jerianne. Thank you very much for inviting me. And thank you for helping me share my word, and encourage everybody, follow me on Instagram, follow me on Twitter, hug Jerianne for me, get a copy of my Audible book, and wear your mask. Spread the message, not the disease.
Thank you. And thank you, Jerianne. So back to you, Jerianne.
Well, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you both. Thank you, Bafaya, and thank you, Ms. Cheryl Lee Ralph, as always, for being here and sharing with us. I know you have very limited time, and we were really honored that you would give us some of your time today. So thank you. We'll be in touch.